WOVU LP Cleveland.
And now, our voices today.
Hello and welcome to Our Voices Today on WOVU 95.9 FM. This is Burton Bell Carr Community Radio, streaming live from WOVU.org and the WOVU mobile app. I hope that all of you out there are feeling good and feeling well. I hope that you were able to drink some fresh water and eat some healthy food. And I hope you got some great rest the night before and you're able to think great, healthy, productive, positive thoughts. And remember, if you are not in that space, don't worry. Another moment is coming by very soon. You have another opportunity to find the joy. I haven't said that in a while. Find the joy, y'all. It's summer. The sun is out. It's warming up. I did catch a bit of a chill the night before or something. People were turning their heat on and all of that. But anyway, we are happy to be here. Again, Our Voices Today, WOVU. I am TC Lewis. And again, I hope that everyone is hopping and popping on this wonderful day. I am excited to bring you another edition of Legal Aid, Legal Aid Society of Cleveland on WOVU 95.9 FM. And we enjoy having the attorneys, our friends now at this point, soon to be family, if y'all keep coming around. But here to answer your questions around civil legal matters. Remember, if you are hearing us talking and you have a question or a comment, always, always, always shoot me a text or leave a voicemail message on the WOVU talkback line, 216-200-7848, 216-200-7848. And so you can also, you know, call Legal Aid directly. Actually, let's see the number, 216-687-1900, 216-687-1900. You can also visit them online, lasclev.org, lasclev.org. You can, get help by phone or online. If you're going online, again, head over to that website and click on Contact Us, and it'll take you to another little button where you can fill out the form online. And a wonderful person from Legal Aid Society right here in Cleveland will get in touch with you. So we have had friends from Legal Aid on Our Voices Today talking about a number of things. We've talked about housing rights. We've talked about healthcare and the law. And so today we are talking about education. And so this is interesting because I was very aware, you know, that lawyers were actually needed, you know, when it comes to, sorting things out in the educational sphere. My friend is sitting next to me, just shaking her head. She's so kind, so kind. So I'll go ahead and introduce her into the mix. Welcome to Our Voices Today and WOVU, attorney Danielle Godomsky Littleton. I got it right.
Yes, you did. Yes. Thank you so much.
I like having you here. You're shaking your head. TC, you are correct. So thank you. And welcome to the program. How are you today?
I'm wonderful, thank you. Yeah. It is great to be here with you.
Yeah, absolutely. In person, we are in person. We are socially distanced and we are fully protected, y'all. So don't even worry about that. So we are, answering some questions. Thank you so much to those who were able to contribute to this conversation. I appreciate all the texts and the emails. Remember, if you ever want to send an email to the program, just type in OVT at WOVU.org. That's OVT at WOVU.org. Danielle, thank you again for joining us. Go ahead and tell us a little bit about yourself, how you came into practicing law, and how you spent your time with Legal Aid Society.
Sure. Well, I've been with the Legal Aid Society of Cleveland for about 8 years now, and I first came to Legal Aid to work with kids in foster care because they have a lot of civil legal issues that impact them outside of where they're going to live or who they're going to live with. Mm-hmm. And one of those big areas was what's going on with them in school. And so I got really passionate and interested about what was going on in their rights in school. And so now I'm a part of our medical legal partnership with university hospitals, where doctors and nurses at the Midtown Clinic can refer legal issues to me that impact kids and women's health. And a lot of those issues tend to be issues at school as well.
Really? Because
again, they're the kid, the pediatric patients. So that's a big part of where I spend my time, but I also dabble in a couple other areas of wherever I can help people out to impact their health.
Yeah, absolutely. Are you from Cleveland?
I'm not. I'm from Columbus, Ohio,
okay.
Actually.
All right. Yeah. Well, yeah. 8 years in the game. Well, you may have been around the city of Cleveland a little bit longer, but 8 years with Legal Aid Society. Why was it important for you to, work with an organization like Legal Aid?
Yeah. Well, like I said, I got to know some people who were impacted by the foster care system, and I just found out that it was such an unjust system. Honestly, and that it impacted people's lives so deeply and in so many ways that I wanted to make a difference in that system. And when I talked with the Legal Aid Society of Cleveland about that passion, they were really excited about moving into the space and learning more about it and doing more advocacy. So I got a grant to work with the Legal Aid Society of Cleveland. So that's why I came to Cleveland and work with them. And, I've had a lot of opportunities and privilege in my life, and it's a joy to be able to give back and be a part of the community that's trying to find solutions to these problems.
Yeah. So there are legal aid offices all around the country,
yes.
Right? Do you guys talk to each other and partner with each other? You get together, have reunions or something like that?
Yeah. I've never been to a national legal aid reunion, but there are legal aids all over the country. We have one common funding stream from the federal government. And so there are some organizations that bring us together around that funding stream. And then there are others that just give legal aids ideas about how we can be making a bigger impact, a better impact. Mm-hmm. But we do work really closely with all the legal aid programs around the state of Ohio.
Okay.
So there are actually 7 legal aid programs in Ohio alone.
Okay.
And so actually just yesterday I was on a call with attorneys all over the state who are working on education issues in Ohio.
Yeah. Yeah, so let's, that's a good segue. Let's talk about what are some of the issues in education in Ohio that legal aid is, that you all are collaborating on to resolve.
So legal aid's education practice pretty much focuses on 3 areas. One is access to school. The second is special education supports in school, and then school discipline. And so when I say access, I'm thinking about things like enrollment problems because of custody status or a living situation, and then also interpretation and translation services, that people who English isn't their first language might have trouble accessing school because of that. And then our special education work is about helping families who ask for an evaluation for a student with disabilities, and then advocating for the right services in their disability. quality plan, and then also making sure that even if the services are right in the plan, that they're actually being provided to the student. And then in school discipline, you know, kids get suspended, and we try to come up with ideas of how they can avoid suspensions in the future by having the school provide more services or approaching in a different way. And then we actually represent families in expulsion hearings to try to make sure kids can stay in school and get the right services.
Yeah, wow. That is a lot. Things that, I mean, it's probably, you know, obvious, like in terms of like discipline, you know, some, it may be helpful to have a legal advisor in that realm. But I don't know. We'll dig more into that. We're going to take our first break. It's we have our friend from the Legal Aid Society here with us today, Danielle Gadomski Littleton. Yes, praise me as I get her name right over and over again throughout this broadcast. But stick around. We are going to be right back. Remember, if you have any questions or comments that I can pass along to Attorney Danielle, please send them to the WOVU Talkback line, 216-200-7848. You can leave a voicemail or send a text, 216-200-7848. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Tuesday, June 22nd, join Ward 5 Councilwoman Dolores Gray and Cleveland Police Chief Calvin Williams as they host a community meeting on the new police headquarters from 6 to 7:30 at the Box Spot, 8005 Kinsman Road, on Tuesday, June 22nd. Share your voice on what you want to see in a new Cleveland Division of Police headquarters. Remember, join us at the Box Spot Tuesday, June 22nd from 6 to 7:30 p.m. If it rains, meet us at Cornucopia Place, right next to WOVU. This is brought to you by Ward 5 Councilwoman Dolores Gray, the Cleveland Division of Police, and WOVU, 95.9 FM, Our Voices United, a Burton Bell Carr community radio station.
Yo, Cleveland!
I got COVID, and you already know this, but I will tell you again, you do not want it. It's whack. It's terrible.
Well, I got vaccinated. Call me Lizzo because we feeling good.
Get educated. Get vaccinated.
Listen, it's free. It's super easy. Click the link in the bio to get more information. Also, when you get vaccinated, you get a free card. Can't beat that.
This is brought to you by Desus and Merrill and WOVU 95.9 FM. Our Voices United, a Burton Bell Carr community radio station.
What's up, Cleveland? It's your girl, Jazzy J, and I just want to know, have you downloaded our app yet? Yes, our app for Androids and iPhones. All you got to do is go to your app store and download WOVU 95.9 FM, and you can listen to us anywhere.
It's time to make the short story longer.
Welcome back. You are tuned in to Our Voices today on WOVU 95.9 FM, Our Voices United. And we are uniting our ears with a special voice today, one of our friends from the Legal Aid Society of Cleveland, Danielle Gadomski Littleton. Yes, TC, you got it right once again. Let me see, what can I do for myself right there? Woo! Yeah. All right. So you got to praise yourself every once in a while. You know what I'm saying? She is with us, Attorney Danielle. She's a part of the Education Practice Group with Legal Aid Society of Cleveland, helping students and families in three primary areas: access to education, special education support, and disciplinary issues. So Danielle, we have some questions, you know, from our audience and a few of our staff members here at WOVU, because it was, just, interesting to, hear people's responses as I'm, you know, letting them know that you're coming. You know, what is it that you would want to know, you know, about education and the law? And a lot of people were kind of stumped. You know, it's like, what do we need a lawyer for? We send our kids to school, they come home, they learn things, they graduate, but there are issues, right? And I don't know if you mentioned this while we were on the air, but you did, you know, talk about, you know, what school a child goes to during like a custody battle, things like that. You mentioned foster care. I'm sure kids who are in the juvenile justice system, right? Yeah. So I guess kind of peel back the layers a little bit on that access piece.
Yeah. So, you know, the families that come to us, trouble just getting into school are those families who don't have the documents necessarily that the school is requesting to enroll their child. And they may not have those documents because, for instance, like a biological father doesn't automatically have custody of their child if they weren't married at the time the child was born. So even if they're the biological father, child's living with them, trying to get them into school, they may not have those custody documents they need to get the child enrolled in school. And so we can help them think through what their options are for that. And there are also some protections for kids who aren't living with their assigned legal custodian. And then also grandparents. Sometimes, you know, kids are living with their grandparents and everything's been going fine until it's time to go to kindergarten and they need something like a grandparent power of attorney to help get their child enrolled in school. But there are those protections for kids who are homeless or unstably housed or in foster care, and they can get enrolled in school even if they don't have the same documents, and they can actually stay in the school they were in when they became homeless or entered foster care, or they can enroll in the new school where they're living. And the school district has to provide transportation back to the old school district for kids in that situation. So that's just some of the laws and protections that are out there that people may not know about when they're in that situation that we can help them navigate.
And those laws are set forth by the state of Ohio?
Actually, those are federal laws protecting homeless and foster care students. So yeah, those are national.
Interesting, interesting stuff. Remember, if you have a question for attorney Danielle Godomsky Littleton, please send a text to the talkback line 216-200-7848. And we'll get that question over to her. So I guess I'll just go ahead and go down like the list of our specific questions. Just trying to, since we were talking about access. Let's see. Well, I guess we could, let's just shift over to special education, because that is, you know, a big topic around education and even just what the term special education means. For those who aren't familiar, or, you know, we could clear this up for a lot of listeners. What is special education all about? We sort of think about it as for students with disabilities, but that's not it, right?
Well, I would say it is for students with disabilities, but I think disability can mean a lot of different things than what people might picture.
Okay.
I know a lot of families come to me saying, you know, I think my child needs help, but I don't want them to be in a special ed classroom. You know, they don't want them to be just in a classroom all day with only other students with disabilities, and they don't want them to feel like they're not being challenged. You know, they want them to have a regular school experience, but get some extra help. And so I have the opportunity to explain to them that special education is a lot different than it was back in the 70s.
Right.
It was kind of revamped completely in the 70s. And now it's about the individual child and what supports they need. And it's a whole range of services. So actually, just to start, when people say special education, there's actually two different plans that could be in place for kids with disabilities. One's called a 504 plan. And it's really just about accommodations for the child. So if they need something to be able to learn differently, like to sit up closer or to get extra breaks, or a child in a wheelchair needs to have all their classes on the first floor, and you know, they can't be assigned to classes upstairs. Those are things that you might put in a 504 plan just to accommodate them. But an individualized education plan, an IEP, is really what people are usually talking about with special education. Okay. And that's a kid who needs to be taught differently. So they might not need to go just to a special education classroom, but they might need a special education teacher in their classroom to kind of break things down differently, teach them a different way, teach them a couple different times to make sure they've really got it. So those are just the kind of different types of disability plans.
Yeah, you mentioned that special education has been revamped since the 70s, and perhaps a lot of the things that we think about when special education comes to mind, you know, it's been updated. What has been like the history of special education and the law, you know, from then compared to now, I guess is my question.
Well, you know, when schools were first created, there were public schools, and they were, well, first of all, often just for white kids, right? And so then there was this inclusion movement to include all kids in public education. But even then, kids that they feel like, well, they may not be able to learn, so let's just leave them at home, they weren't included. Then there was this movement to, okay, let's bring them into the school, but we'll put them into this special classroom. Or often those classrooms were like in the basement or just completely separate. And it wasn't a lot about them learning, but it was just kind of, you know, people think of like they went on a lot of field trips or they had like experiences, but it wasn't always about making sure they had life skills or learning academics. And so the federal government did get involved in the 70s and say, let's make sure kids with disabilities are included in the classroom because they can learn and because they're members of our society. We value them as people. We give them dignity. And so they now, there's a requirement that they're in their least restrictive environment, meaning like they're around kids without disabilities as much as possible, as appropriate for them. And there's this individual plan that's created for them to give them services, and we track progress. That's not to say there's still not problems and discrimination that's involved, all these biases that can come into these plans, but it's definitely a lot better than when we just left kids at home and assumed they couldn't learn.
Yeah. So how would I know if my child may need special education services and... I don't know. Is that a question for you?
That's a great question. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You know, I think a lot of families, well, they might know before child's even in school that they're not meeting their developmental milestones. You know, if there's a delay in talking or in walking or they're not getting along with their peers. Like sometimes I get families who the kid has been from daycare to daycare and the daycare just keeps saying, we can't handle this. You know, like you've got to take them out. And so there's this actually like expulsion from daycare and preschool that goes on a lot. And so, you know, we can talk to them about there are early intervention services that are available to kids from 0 to 3 and where the teacher or person comes to the home and gives the family different ideas and strategies. But then once kids get to preschool, again, you might see like they don't really know any letters or numbers or again, not getting along with peers is a big red flag. And so then an evaluation request would go to the school district because they're responsible for kids from age 3 to 22. But school age kids, you know, there's all sorts of things that might be red flags, frequent suspensions, grades not keeping up. You know, there's this now this third grade reading guarantee where kids have to be held back in the third grade if they don't pass this reading test. If we see retention there or even at any grade, if you see kids being retained a lot. And so those are all things that if people are like, you know, this isn't going right in school, they might talk to their doctors about and see if there is that can be evaluated for a medical diagnosis. But even if they don't have a medical diagnosis of a disability, it might be something to ask the school about doing an evaluation to see if they have an educational disability, which is a little bit different.
Yeah, I can imagine families are hesitant to kind of dive into this special education because they feel like their child may be stigmatized, you know, and labeled, or may you know, they have that fear of just their kid being stuck in a room in the dungeon in the basement, or even, you know, bullied by other kids when they know, when it's known that this person has an IEP. How do you kind of like when you're working with a family, these issues are arising, you guys are having this discussion, how do you assuage their fears? And allow them to make the best decision for their child?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think there's both. I think some families really fear it, and some families have been asking for it for years and have just been pushed away because there's this other stigma about, like, well, your kid's just not trying very hard, or they're just not a very good child. They don't know how to behave. Maybe you as a parent are doing something wrong. And so these families have been like, sort of told this, and they're like, no, really, there is something that the school could be doing to help. So I think there's both. But I definitely see a fear of stigma and labeling. And, you know, I tell them there's possibility they could be labeled anyways. They could be labeled as a bad child. They could be labeled as a lazy child. And in fact, it may be that they already are being labeled that way. Yeah. So let's reframe it as actually it's a disability where they need help. Right. And there's something we can do about it. You know, there's all these different categories that are part of special education. Like, you have to pick which disability category the child might fall into. And so we definitely talk about the stigma associated with some of them. There's one called, like, emotional disturbance, which has a lot of stigmas. Just the name, right? and so we move away from that. Like, we look at other categories that have less stigma and less labeling attached to it. And I just talk to them about it's a way for your child to get help.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a private document. It's not the thing that everyone needs to know about. I've had a lot of families recently are worried about their kids being singled out in class. And so we just talk with that about the whole team that's creates the plan, and talk to him about how important it is for the child not to be singled out and that they want to be in the same classroom. And how can we do things for the whole classroom that benefit that individual child, but that it's not directed at that one child. So definitely take those fears into concern.
Yeah. How do you recognize whether or not your child or your family is being discriminated against in the sphere of education?
Yeah. I think that's a really hard one. You know, I mean, I think that obviously people are rarely going to say that, you know, that I'm treating you this way differently because of this thing about your family. And there's definitely a distinction between unfair discrimination, which all discrimination is unfair, and then illegal discrimination. You know, sometimes families will tell me, I feel like I'm being treated differently than this other family because this teacher didn't like my older child. And my older child act up a lot. And so they think my kids, you know, my younger kids isn't going to be a bad kid. So that's possible. It's hard to say exactly what that teacher is thinking. I mean, I can't really say how you might know that's happening. But unfortunately, that's unfair discrimination, but not illegal discrimination. Wow. Yeah, the illegal discrimination comes in where you think that someone at the school is treating your child differently because of their race, because of their gender, their national origin. Like we talked about before, sometimes language, you know, if they're not getting what they need because of the language they speak. So those are all, and then disability status again. So if your child has ADHD and can't sit down and attend in the same way as other kids, and they're constantly being punished for that, that's a form of discrimination. And so we can deal with it a couple different ways through supports, but also there are complaints you can file because of discrimination in school.
Wow. Yeah, that's a lot. And like you said, sometimes it's just a feeling like something is not, something is off. It's not right. You know, your kid may be coming home and, you know, explaining these incidents and, you know, you don't really know where to put it. Well, if you need help sorting those things out, Legal Aid Society of Cleveland is here for you. You can get in touch with them by phone, or online. The phone number is 216-687-1900, 216-687-1900. You can also contact them online and fill out their intake form. Just Head on over to lasclev.org. That's lasclev.org. Check them out, you know, during the break. We'll be back with more with education and the law. Woo, getting it tongue-tied here, but I'm going to get her name right through this whole show. Attorney Danielle Godomsky-Littleton is here with us from the Legal Aid Society of Cleveland. You are listening to Our Voices today on WOVU 95.9 FM. We'll be right back.
Richer and the poor don't get. Excuse me, but I get so mad. Where could we have been?
We are celebrating Black Music Month here at WOVU 95.9 FM. Miles Davis is one of the most accomplished jazz trumpet players in music history. He won 8 Grammy Awards, including the Lifetime Achievement Award. Davis was born in 1926 in Alton, Illinois, near St. Louis, to a mother who was a violinist and a father who was a dentist. Born with a musical background, Davis received his first trumpet at age 9 and took lessons from Elwood Buchanan, a jazz trumpeter who was a patient under his father. Davis performed in his first gig at age 17 and attended the Juilliard School of Music in 1944, where he played in Charlie Parker's band and was also mentored under trumpeter Dizzy Gillespie. He signed with Columbia Records after performing at the world-famous Newport Jazz Festival in 1955, before eventually forming the first of 2 quintets. Over the next 45 years, Miles Davis evolved his musical style to master bebop, jazz fusion, funk, blues, African rhythms, and more. He also used the harmon mute to introduce different sounds. Davis is well known for his improvisation and famously said, "Don't play what's there, play what's not there." His notable albums include Roundabout Midnight, Birth of the Cool, Kinda Blue, and In a Silent Way. Miles Davis performed his final concert in 1991 at the Holiday Bowl just weeks before he passed away, but his legacy lives on through his innovation and his ability to play with multiple genres and sounds. This celebration of Black Music Month is brought to you by WOVU 95.9 FM, Our Voices United, a Burton Bell Carr community radio station.
Welcome back. You are tuned in to Our Voices today on WOVU 95.9 FM. I am TC Lewis. It's Legal Aid Society Day here with us. We are continuing our monthly conversations with our friends at Legal Aid Society of Cleveland. Their website is lasclev.org. Last Cleve, I feel like sometimes the website names like can be confusing if you don't spell it out. So it's lasclev.org, or give them a call to their intake line, 216-687-1900, 216-687-1900. Maybe you're an attorney and you want to, you know, contribute to the efforts of Legal Aid Society. You can go to the website and find out how to do that as well. And for all those other do-gooders out there, they do accept volunteers, okay? Because they want to continue helping those who are underserved get the legal access that you deserve. Legal Aid Society also working with, United Way, the 211, Right to Counsel. Remember, if you have an issues or if someone you know, a lot of times we know people who are going through things, and we hear about information that could help them. It's not necessarily relevant to our own lives. Be sure to pass that on, you know, as you're listening to WOVU. We share a lot. And so even if it doesn't help you, make sure you tell a friend, phone a friend. Do we still do that? maybe texting. Are we Zooming our friends now? I don't know. Whatever. So anyway, Attorney Danielle is here with us. We're talking about education and the law. We've talked about access to education, special education. Now let's get into, you know, that nitty-gritty area of discipline. You know, expulsion, suspensions, in-school detention, in-school suspension, you know, getting into skirmishes with student to student, teacher to student. Let's see, I'll just start with a question here from our wonderful audience. Can legal aid assist with resolving issues between students or between students and teachers?
Yeah, our work at Legal Aid is really focused on disagreements between families in the school rather than between students. But, you know, a lot of schools do have peer mediator programs that they really are trying to build up to resolve those. Also, a lot of school districts, and specifically the Cleveland Metropolitan School District, has an ombudsman office where families can file complaints if they have concerns about the staff. Also, you know, there's always a principal of the school that's a good person to go to. So that's usually where we send people if they have those concerns. But, you know, if there's bullying going on between students, that might be a situation, especially if it's related to the child's disability, that we could help with, because we could make it part of the IEP plan, you know, how the school needs to respond to the bullying related to the child's disability. And, you know, if a school staff member or other student is discriminating against a child based on that race, gender, national origin, or disability status, and the school is not responding, because there is a process where you, you know, you tell the school, they're supposed to investigate, they're supposed to report back. And if that's not happening, then you could consider a complaint to the Department of Education, the Federal Department of Education, and we could give families information about that.
Yeah. So, you know, my kid is misbehaving. I've done all I can do. I feel like the teachers are ragging on them, the administrators. How can legal aid step in?
Yeah. Well, first I would want to have a conversation about, like, what you think the real, you know, cause of the problem. And it could be a couple of things. Yeah. One, you know, your child could not be meeting the expectations of the classroom, but also the teacher is really not responding very well. And so if we think there is anything related to your child's disability, we would start there. We'd start with an evaluation, because that often opens up the conversation for individual supports for the child. But if it's about, you know, being suspended or expelled on a frequent basis, you know, we could suggest that they talk to the school about the proper placement for the child, you know, whether they're in the best classroom for them. And again, I mean, we hate to always tie it back to disability, but because there are those special supports for kids with disability, it's kind of like a trade-off. You know, are you going to go down that road just to get those special supports? So that's usually where we kind of steer the conversation.
Good information. Good information. Remember, if you have a question for Danielle, you can send it to the talkback line, 216-200-7848, 200-7848. Leave a voicemail or send a text, because this is good stuff, especially in the realm of discipline. So what if my student misses school a lot, you know, and they're getting into trouble? And actually, this question came from a friend of mine. Their child was in an online school. And thinking that online was more flexible than traditional in-person, back when everybody was in-person, you know, their kid was kind of just getting up and getting on the platform and doing the work, but not enough hours according to their standards, right, per day. And apparently that was, like, against the rules. And, you know, they cited it's state of Ohio law. You know, a kid has to be in attendance, counted for attendance a certain amount of hours. Like, is that, you know, a typical situation? Like, is it legal for kids to be kicked out of school, you know, just for not coming?
Yeah, there's a lot to that question. Yeah. So obviously this came up a lot with COVID, right? Like you said, everyone is being educated online and our kids actually logged in.
Yeah.
Like they're trying to log in. They have technology problems. So there is mandatory school attendance for parents. Like you have to get your kids to school. But setting that aside, then there's attendance for kids. Like they could be charged with truancy.
Right.
Usually it's the younger kids where they come after the parents and the older kids where they might pursue truancy in juvenile court. And so, yeah, there is those like standard amount of instruction hours that are supposed to be provided. And whether that's an traditional in-person school, a lot of those online schools or before COVID were charter schools. And so they're free schools, but they're not connected necessarily to one of the districts. And so those are bound by the same laws that the district schools are, the charter schools are. There are some private schools, obviously. I don't think any of those online schools are necessarily private schools where you have to pay for them to attend. But private schools are kind of a separate issue. Maybe we can get to it in a minute. So, but for charter and district schools, whether they're online or in person, there was a law in 2017 that said you can't kick kids out of school for not coming to school.
Okay.
That makes no sense.
Okay.
I have to tell you, though, I saw it. You know, I was practicing before 2017 and I saw kids. You know, one kid in particular, I think about, he'd walk into the school, walk out the back, and then they would suspend him, so then he didn't have to even walk in the school for the next week.
It worked out for him.
Yeah, exactly. It was exactly what he was looking for, and he wasn't getting the supports he needed when he was there. So they can't do that anymore. They can't suspend or expel for absences. But families are going to start seeing these letters, and they have been seeing these letters where your kids miss this many hours of instruction, because they don't count by days anymore. They count by hours. So it kind of adds up pretty fast. And then what the school is supposed to do is create like an absence intervention team to find out like what's going on. You know, like maybe in that scenario, he is getting the work done, but he's not logged in for the amount of time. Well, maybe he doesn't know that. Like maybe the family's not aware. So can we work it out that way?
Yeah.
For traditional schools, like, are they having trouble with transportation? Is there a food issue at home? You know, is the older child staying home to take care of a younger one? Like, how can we support that family is the idea of that law. And so that team's supposed to come together and make up a plan before they can go file truancy charges.
Right.
Because juvenile court really can't do a whole lot if the problem is just like a problem with the, you know, that the family needs help resolving. Juvenile court's not going to be able to do that.
Yeah. And I'm sure you've experienced a lot of times the issues a kid is having in school is not really due inherently to, because of that kid. It's because they need something that's not being taken care of or addressed. So again, here with us today, another friend from Legal Aid Society of Cleveland, attorney Danielle Godomsky-Littleton. She is a part of the education practice group at Legal Aid. Let's see, so we talked a little bit about where we touched on private schools and charter schools. Do students of private and charter schools still have like the same rights as public school students?
Yeah. So charter schools actually go in the public school bucket.
Okay.
So if you think about, like, you know, if you're thinking about a district school, you're thinking about, you know, I'm looking out the window at the Cleveland Metropolitan School across the street.
Anton Gardena, shout out.
Yeah. And you know, and the charter schools are all the schools that you can just walk in, say, I want my child to go here. It's free. Like, so then that's how you know it's a charter school.
Yeah.
There obviously are lots of private schools, and there are private schools that accept scholarships and vouchers. So it may be that you don't have to end up paying, but you had to go through a whole process. You had to apply. You had to apply for the voucher. So you would know if you were in this private school. And those schools actually aren't bound by the same laws that district and charter schools are. They don't have to follow the same discipline laws. So typically in a public school, you have to go through all these, like, sending notices home. You have to have hearings for an expulsion. A private school can just say, we don't want you to come back. And then they also don't have to do the same special education that district and charter schools have to do. They do have to accommodate students and they can't discriminate against students, because most private schools still end up getting some money from the government. Right. So we're able to tell them, like, okay, you can't say, like, we're only accepting kids without disabilities. Mm-hmm. You can't say that. Mm-hmm. But if the kid with disability is enrolled there, you don't necessarily have to provide all the same services that a public school would have to provide to be able to support them. Hmm. Some schools do. You know, there are a couple private schools in Cleveland that still want to provide services for kids with disabilities, but typically they don't have to provide those same. They don't have to.
Okay. Private schools do not have to provide disability services. What about, how does legal aid help students who are perhaps maybe in trade school or on college campuses? Like, is there an intersection there?
Yeah, you know, we have not had as many families coming to us about that, but there are still those protections against discrimination and the right to request accommodations. So if families have had, you know, a child has had a 504 plan or an IEP in high school, then they do have the right to have some of those accommodations for them in college if they still need them. Mm-hmm. And there's usually like a disability office that's in charge of those accommodations in the trade school or the college. And so we can advise people that they still have those rights. We can connect them with the office. But we haven't really been involved in meetings at those schools as much. Okay. But those accommodations still can be provided.
Huh. So when can I, as a parent or a family, like, when is it ever necessary to, like, take legal action against, like, a teacher or a school district?
Yeah. Yeah, we definitely get families who contact us. And if the reason they want to take action is because they want disability supports for the child, we go into our whole process of, you know, helping advocate for the child to have the supports they need going forward. Because the special education laws, they require you to go through a couple steps. You would request evaluations, you would work with the school. If you couldn't come to a resolution, you'd file a complaint with the state, but it's not a lawsuit. It's just kind of like actually just a piece of paper that asks, like, what did they do wrong?
Right.
And so anyone could do that.
Okay.
And it's really nice. You don't have to have a lawyer to do that. And then if all that didn't work out, then you could file a lawsuit. But in special education, you can't really recover money for the school doing things wrong. You would just recover what we call compensatory education, which could be like a summer program or tutoring. So when people come and say, like, I'd like to sue the school, I try to figure out, like, is it because of this? Because then let's do this project process together. And usually they could be happy. Sometimes families are wanting to sue because of, like, really, really bad bullying or discrimination. And those are actually not lawsuits that we handle at Legal Aid. So I definitely encourage those people to call the Cleveland Metropolitan Bar Association.
Okay.
And ask for an expert to evaluate those cases. But there are attorneys that handle those types of cases to consider. Basically, it's if there's bullying or discrimination that the school's known about and hasn't done anything about over a long period of time, and you can show there's some sort of damage to you or your family, like, you know, maybe the child dropped out or had some sort of, like, psychological damage, had to go to a lot of therapy. Those are the kinds of cases that a private attorney might consider.
Wow. Okay. So we have learned so much here today with our friend attorney Danielle Godomsky Littleton. Her expertise right now is in the realm of education. Remember, if you need any type of legal advice outside of criminal stuff, right? You can call, including education though, you can call Legal Aid Society, 216-687-1900, 216-687-1900. One of the reasons why I love having you, Danielle, and our other friends from Legal Aid is because we're not always aware of the rights that we have. And so thank you for coming on and sharing with us, you know, a little bit something that maybe we can take back into our regular lives, looking at the window, waving at friends outside of WOVU. So let's see. I think that, you know, is there anything else that we need to make sure that the listening audience knows, you know, before we wrap it up here about education and the law or legal aid?
Yeah, I guess I would just really encourage people to call to talk to us about their concerns about their kids' education. Because like you said, people don't always know that lawyers are involved in school issues, but there are a lot of laws in schools. And so that means that people need lawyers to help them navigate it and to make sure their rights are protected. Because education is such an important part of making society more fair and more equal and giving opportunity. So we hope that people reach out.
Yeah. And remember, lawyers aren't just people who like are helping other people like sue you. Lawyers are experts in the law, like Danielle just said. And sometimes you don't even know you need a lawyer. So like what I love is especially with something like school and, you know, when you feel like you've hit a brick wall in a situation, and it just seems like there's nothing left to do, call Legal Aid. They may be able to give you some advice to help you push through to get to where you are going. Well, you know, thank you so much again, Danielle Gadomski Littleton. I'm not even going to say your name anymore because the next time I'll probably get it wrong. But thank you so much for joining us on the program today. Shout out to our friend Aaron at Legal Aid, helping us to curate these wonderful conversations. And shout out to you, our listening audience. Remember, Legal Aid is just a click away at their website, lasclev.org. That's lasclev.org. You can fill out their intake form online, or you can call and do it by phone at this number, 216-687-1900, 216-687-1900. You have been listening to Our Voices today on WOVU 95.9 FM. Remember, if you have any comments or questions, you can always send us an email, ovt@wovu.org. Or shout us out on the talkback line, 216-200-7848. Have a wonderful day, Cleveland.